and welcome to Computer Workshop. I'm your host, Steve Reeves, filling in for Dean Crutchfield. Our show today is the second part of a two-part series on how to make music with your PC. Today we'll show you how to edit music using your computer. We'll also show you how your PC can be used as a musical tool through the Musical Instrument Digital Interface, commonly known as MIDI. For those of you not familiar with our show, we are live. During the program, you can call in with your questions and comments about today's topic. So feel free to give us a call, and our number in Houston is 713-749-8345. And if you're calling long distance, the number is 1-800-364-8200. Our guests today are Vic Mignogna, who's the music director and composer from Soundworks, and audio for Broadcast Production Studio in Houston, Texas, and Bill Palmer, the founder and coordinator of the MIDI Special Interest Group for Houston Area League of PC Users. Hey guys, welcome to the show.
Hello there, Steve.
That was like a tongue twister there trying to get in there.
It was.
It was a lot, both of you, introducing you and the MIDI. I guess the best way we had to do is to start off, in case someone didn't see the show last week on the introduction to MIDI, why don't you tell us, Vic, tell us, what is MIDI?
Well, as you said in your opening, MIDI stands for Musical Instrument Digital Interface. What that basically means in layman's terms, one of which I am very much a layman as far as computers go, is that instead of recording music the traditional way where the sounds go right down to a piece of tape and you are unable to change them, what it basically means is all of the different elements of a musical instrument, facets of how an instrument plays, like velocity, how loud it plays, duration, how long it plays, attack, how hard it plays when you hit it. All of those different elements have been turned into numbers, basically, digital, into numbers, numerical information that is loaded into a computer, pulses, clicks, and those numbers control different keyboards, different generators of sound that allow you to create music and still be able to manipulate the music. That's the key. MIDI allows you to change instruments and qualities of sounds after you've already recorded it, because nothing is down on tape. It's all in the computer.
Great.
So you've got a great deal of versatility with MIDI music.
All right, and what we've got, you've got a program here, Bill, that actually shows us how MIDI interfaces with your computer, how your keyboard interfaces through MIDI to the computer, and that's actually how we're all connected here.
That's right.
Why don't you go ahead and show us something here?
Okay, basically what I've got here, and I'm going to show you how we edit this stuff.
What program is this?
This is called Cakewalk Professional for Windows. This is a what you might call a mid-range MIDI program.
All right.
Anybody can use it. It's got a graphical user interface, just like stuff you'd have on the Mac or some of the other computers like that.
Right.
Very easy to use. Now, what we've got up here is a MIDI file. This is a file that can be read by any MIDI program, and I'm going to play a lead against this MIDI file and record it right here in front of you.
All right.
Now, right up here, you can see a tempo setting. It's 108 beats per minute. That's faster than I can really play this tune without messing up. So I'm going to go over here and cut it in half speed here, just like that. There.
All right.
Then I'm going to record part of the lead, and it'll sound like this. We're going to get a metronome countdown.
You're actually going to play here.
Yeah.
Right.
Here it comes. The whole thing several times, and then I'd have the whole song recorded.
Right.
Next, I would assign a sound to each one of the voices I had recorded. In this case, I've assigned a reverb flute sound that's on my Proteus. That's a synthesizer that's over here in the little cabinet behind me. It's a rack-mounted synthesizer, has no keyboard, it strictly produces sounds.
All right.
When I play that back at normal speed, it will sound like this. That little clicking is a metronome.
Right, metronome, that little thing that goes back. What is this song?
It's a Sailor Hornpipe. Now, the reason that I recorded this was that I have a friend who is a Highland dancer. He did the Sailor's Hornpipe as part of his show. I didn't like the arrangement that he had, so I figured I would come up with a better arrangement for him.
Right.
He It didn't even use the regular sailor's hornpipe like this one that we know so well, the one from the famous Popeye cartoon.
Right.
The finished product turned out to be this, right here.
Now this is edited, you actually edited this and added more things to it? And
right, I added an introduction and so forth. I've got two different string sounds here and here, and two different flute sounds here and here.
Yeah, you can see a lot of new tracks.
Yeah, lots of stuff, and it sounds like this. We added an introduction here at the front.
And all the new instruments and everything.
Mm-hmm. And you'll hear a flute playing against string with responses.
Again, this software is Cakewalk.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is this anybody can use this? I mean, this
absolutely.
You don't have to be any special person to
no.
Music. I mean, an actual musician. You can actually play around with this and actually edit and change music on the fly. Right?
That's right. As a matter of fact, you don't have to be any good at all to use it. You can play way over your head because you can enter these things just one note at a time. You can go into their recording window here. They have what's called step record. With that, you simply pull the value of the note up on the screen. Here, I'll show you what it looks like. This is pretty neat. You pull the value up. Let's say you want to play a quarter note. You just highlight that, or you can hit the Q on your computer, and that will do the same thing. Then you just hit the note, and then when you let go, did you see how that moved over there?
Right.
That means that recorded that quarter note. If I want to enter an eighth note, I just go over here, and I do the same thing. If I want a 16th note, I can come here. If I want a 32nd note, I can either bop there or I can do that, and it calls it right down there. So I can just sit there with the music, the sheet music in front of me, and enter this thing one note at a time. Takes a while to do it, but if you want to hear the song badly enough, that's what you'll do.
Right. So every single note is editable.
That's right. You can edit the length, the duration, the pitch, the tempo, the velocity, which is how hard it's played.
Right.
That determines how loud or soft it is. Or you can even do global edits. Like I could mark a track, and I could lower the entire volume of it, or I could raise the volume, or do anything I want to.
So it works a lot like a word processor.
Exactly. It's a mini event processor.
Right.
That's precisely.
So you can, if you wanted to change everything to bold text, same thing here. You could change everything to another anything. Everything's
yes.
changeable.
And one of the advantages of this over the old tape recording, which again is still part of the process we use at certain points in it, is that if I want to change the tempo, I can do that without changing the pitch. If I want to change the pitch, I can do that without changing the tempo. On regular tape, that was impossible to do.
Oh, okay.
Because mm-hmm. every time you change the tempo, you change the pitch.
It was like we spoke about earlier. We were talking about how the beauty of MIDI and why MIDI is so wonderful is because all musical instruments pretty much speak the same language.
Right.
That's it. MIDI is a common language between instruments. The different facets we talked about just a few minutes ago about, you know, how hard an instrument hits and how long it plays and, you know, how it stops, how loud it plays. Those are common to all instruments. MIDI has basically become a common language between all instruments.
Because actually you're linked in through him.
Yes,
him, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. If he didn't like a particular sound or voice off of, let's say, his Kawai, he might want to take it off of this keyboard. And MIDI allows him to do that because the information is all that is saved, really. The actual sounds of the instruments are not saved, just the information.
That's exactly
so
right.
he can interchange different sounds to play different parts.
And that's one of the other things that's nice about this is since the computer is storing just the note on and note off messages and just the what kinds of sounds are supposed to be played, not the actual sounds themselves, but the numbers that tell the machines which sound to play, the files are very small. You can put a whole symphony on one disc.
Okay.
And all you have to do is have the right machines to play it.
And that was one thing they talked about last week, the difference between a WAV file and a MIDI file. WAV files are huge. MIDI files are compressed.
Very tiny.
They're a lot smaller. They can fit them on discs.
That's right.
Now, you've got all this fun stuff here, computers and synthesizers, keyboards, everything else. You can do the same. If you don't have all that fun stuff, can you do the same thing on what
heavens.
You have here?
Yes, yes. And that's the neat thing about this. I shouldn't say this on a computer show, but I'm not a computer type of person. I'm one of those kind of people who don't make me deal with how something comes about or how to get it. I just want to push a button and there's sound, you know. This particular keyboard, the Korg 01W, represents a lot of keyboards, workstations, they call them. It's not just a synthesizer. They call them workstations. And the reason they do is because This basically incorporates just about every element here, all in one self-contained package.
But that really is a computer because it has a disk drive.
Yeah.
And it must store things?
Yeah, it has all of the same elements. It has a sequencer, which for people that don't know what a sequencer, they hear that word a lot nowadays. A sequencer basically is a digital recorder that allows you to record notes and information. It has a sequencer built into it, 16 tracks. It has all kinds of editing functions within the sequencer. You can change note values and sustains and even the pitches. You can transpose an entire piece of music. If I sing a song in a certain range or a certain key, and you come along and say, "Boy, Vic, I love that song, I just wish it weren't so high." Well, with a push of a button, as he can do with this program as well, it can become a song right in your
play
range.
Play something fun there. Can you play just
play something fun? Well, here's a sequence of something that I was working on. This particular board I love because Korg is really dedicated to acoustic sounds, trying to reproduce acoustic sounds as much as possible.
Right.
You're hearing piano, some strings, some bell tones. In fact, we've got a piece of the screen here that I can show you.
I think we have a tape actually.
Yes. Yeah. Let's take a look at it.
Why don't we run that up, bring it up on the screen, and you can actually go through and so people can see what you're doing there.
I'd be so happy to do that.
Okay. We're going to put Todd on the spot here, the director. There it is.
Roll the tape. Okay, what you're looking at here is the screen. Up in the upper left corner is the name of the song, Two of a Kind. And then each of those little play signs represents a different track. Now you notice how the screen just changed. There are each of the numbers over top of the tracks represents the volume of the track. You can adjust that very easily. Down in the corner, you've got the beats, how fast the song plays. The measure numbers clicking off there, 19, 20, 21, and 3/4 time, you can see that. And the M off means the metronome, or the counter that you would use to play along with to keep in time, is turned off right now. It just changed again. Now it says pan. If you see down in the bottom right, it says pan. The 5/5 over top of each of the little tracks tells you where in the stereo spectrum the sounds are located. If it were 9/1, for instance, that would mean that particular sound was playing mostly out of the left side and just a little bit out of the right.
Because a lot of times what's actually showing up there is somewhat the same as what's showing up on the screen here.
It's virtually identical, right. So if you don't have the money or the wherewithal or the, in my case, the understanding of how all of this stuff works real easily, one package,
Right.
And there are values to both.
Right. So we really have two different types of composers here, I guess.
Well, yes.
Yeah, and another thing to bear in mind, too, is that if you already have a computer, then the biggest expense is pretty well taken care of. Because if you already have a computer, you don't need to buy that part, and you can just buy, if you're, let's say, a regular consumer like most of the people who are using MIDI today, you can buy an inexpensive keyboard, and that will have your sounds and the keys on it so that you have...
Right.
Basically, the second part of the three things you need, or I should say four things you need to have a MIDI set up.
Right.
You need a computer or something to store sounds. You need a piece of software that would be a sequencer program or whatever, like Cakewalk. Then your synthesizer, and you need something to connect the two together. That's your MIDI interface.
While we're talking about MIDI again, keep bringing up MIDI. Why don't you tell us a little bit about how did MIDI begin?
Well, back in the old days when I used to be a professional musician, which has been a long time ago, synthesizers were just coming out. And if you wanted to get different kinds of sounds, you had to buy different synthesizers. You had the Mini Moog, which was one of the early ones, then you had the ARP, and you had the Prophet, and all of these other different ones, and they did different things. Some of these guys would have a dozen keyboards. And it was really rough trying to play all of them at the same time. People were actually trying to come up with ways to connect one keyboard to several different instruments. They came up with proprietary methods that not only meant that you could only use them with their own keyboards, but they also were quite expensive. So in 1982, Dick Smith with Sequential Circuits and some other people at Yamaha and Roland and some of the other big synthesizer manufacturers got together and came up with the MIDI interface, which allowed them to play one keyboard from another. Once they were able to get those numbers to go out and to be recognized by other keyboards, then the idea of storing them in a computer was just the obvious next step. And
right.
and that really was the key to it. And it's opened up a real world to everybody.
All right, now, people can tell if they have a MIDI interface on their keyboard, for example. There's actually a five-pin connection on the back of it, right?
That's exactly right. There's a little connector. In fact, there's three of them on the back of his Korg over here that are next to each other. And if you see those three things, or even two of those on the back of your keyboard, then you can probably connect it up to your computer if you get a MIDI interface.
So there's a MIDI in, a MIDI out, and a through.
Right. The in and out are absolutely necessary. The through is not absolutely necessary unless you want to add something else to the system through that. But you have to have a MIDI in and a MIDI out to use your keyboard for a MIDI keyboard to use with your computer.
All right. You keep talking about synthesizers, too,
mm-hmm.
and samplers. You were talking about samplers. What's the difference between a synthesizer and a sampler?
Well, the main difference is that a synthesizer does just what it says. It synthesizes a sound. It's not the real sound. It just sounds like the real sound. And
right.
I can remember... I remember going into Radio Shack when I was about 12 years old, right when stuff like this started coming out.
God, you were young.
Like 2 years ago?
Yeah, thank you. And I'd go in there and I'd look at one of these little keyboards and it would say violins. And I would think, wow, a violin in a keyboard.
Right.
And I'd play and it would sound...
Right.
It, you know, just didn't quite have it there. But it was an attempt at that time to synthesize the sound of a violin.
Right.
So synthesizers basically just, they electronically try to shift waves and adjust sound waves to match the wave of a particular instrument.
Right.
Now, a sampler, however, is basically just an elaborate recorder. It actually records a sound. Anything that can be heard, a sampler can record. It can record the sound of you breathing. It can record...
A door slamming.
Anything. Cars revving up. Birds chirping. Musical instruments. And what it does is it converts that sound that you're hearing into digital information, loads it into a computer, and then the computer allows you to recall it on the keyboard by playing.
What do people use samples for? I mean,
I tell you what, you know, it's funny because the office that I work at, SoundWorks, we have a synclavier system. And it's funny because technology is moving so fast nowadays.
Right.
Some people I've said before, oh, we have a synclavier, we work off a synclavier. And I think that's pretty impressive because it's an incredible system. And some people say, oh, that's a dinosaur. You know, synclavier's a dinosaur. Well, it's interesting they should choose that word dinosaur because Jurassic Park, which is out right now and which probably most people would agree is about the hottest thing
right.
technologically that has come out with sound and special effects recently, was reading an article where the sound designer of Jurassic Park used the synclavier. He'd go out, he'd record elephants, tigers, bears, all different sorts of animals. He loaded the information into a computer, melded the different sounds together to create a dinosaur, you know,
right.
T-Rex.
What does a T-Rex sound like?
Right. And then he loaded it into a synclavier and was able to watch the screen, and as the T-Rex would breathe or step or growl, he would just play it right off the keyboard.
Hmm.
And the beautiful thing about it is if he played it a little bit late, no problem. Go right into the computer
and move it over.
Slide it right back because it's digital information.
Computers are great, aren't they?
Yeah, it is. They're scary.
I just made that up. Computers are great. Do you have any samples we can listen to on there?
Well,
what do you got?
This keyboard. I'm glad you said that because this keyboard is a combination of the two. This keyboard has what they call bit samples, PCM samples,
oh, okay.
And PCM stands for
pulse code modulation.
That's why we brought it. Thank you, Bill.
That's right. He's here for all the real technical stuff. That's right.
Acronyms.
What that means is that Korg took a piece of a sound, a piece of a piano, for instance, the basic elements of the piano sound, and stored that in the computer. And then instead of having a huge, big sample, which they really are, in order to get all the subtle little nuances, the overtones, and the resonance of a real piano,
right.
They built the rest of the sound synthetically.
Oh.
So let me I'll show you. This is a piano. You know, this is a... It's a beautiful piano, and most people, you know, would think that's a piano.
Like a piano.
Yeah, and you know, it's got the low end. You know, it's got the, it's close enough to the original that, you know, that's a piano.
Right.
But it doesn't have every different element. They build it synthetically and with samples. He's got, Proteus, he's got some different keyboards that are full samples.
Right.
They do nothing but play back digitally sampled information.
A lot of people don't realize most of the music you listen to on the radio are all done.
I tell you, I'm not kidding. I constantly turn the radio on and hear something, and I go, oh, that's a piano sound off of an M1, or that's that bell tone, I've heard that off of a Roland, you know. Because that's what music is now, and it's so cost effective.
Right.
Because you don't have to bring in 5 or 10 musicians, spend hours getting a track tight, getting everybody play together, rolling tape over and over again, spending hours in the studio. You sit in your living room, you know, in between, you know, Dr. Pepper's, and you write stuff. And if you don't like it, you change it. And when you're done, you take the keyboard or you take the computer, the sequence, into a recording studio. You send each instrument out a separate output track of the keyboard, send it to its own track of multi-track tape. And when you're done with that, you're basically where you started 10 years ago with each instrument on its own track.
And what's great is you can just give your disc to somebody else, right? I mean, if you had that disc, you could
just
take
like
pieces
this
up.
Here.
Yeah. Okay, now you play that, and you can see what he made, and you don't even have to be in the same city, and you can, you know, everyone can talk to
you. You can mail it. As a matter of fact, one of the neat parts about this is with the advent of standard MIDI files just a few years ago, you can cross platforms. A friend of mine in Portland, for instance, sent me a set of MIDI files that he had generated on his Macintosh, and I can read them on my PC, and I can call them right up and play them. All I have to do is figure out what sounds I want to go at what particular point, and that's it. One thing that's sort of ironic about this discussion about sampling is the Kawai uses a different type of sampling. They use wavetable synthesis, which means they use sections of sounds. They put them together to make what they want.
Right.
The Roland D50 is one of the standard synthesizer sounds. It's strictly synthesis. They sampled the sound in sections and put it on this keyboard. Here it is. That is a D50.
Yes. If I've ever heard a D50.
Yeah,
that's D50.
It. Oh, I thought it was a D49.
So that was the old World War II model. But hey, we wouldn't have beat Germany without that.
I get those mixed up all the time. My D49, D50. I can never. Why don't we show something else on the computer here?
Okay.
This is actually what Band in a Box.
This is Band in a Box. Now, this is a neat program. It's a combination of recreation and composition. If you're an old, tired, worn out former musician like I am, and you played a lot in old bars and things, and you don't have a band to work
with. You don't have to bring that
this,
up if you don't want to.
Oh, hey, I love it. Hey, I'm still alive. It's more than I can say for some of my friends. You can use this program. This is a song called Caravan. It's an old jazz standard, and it was one of the things I used to have a lot of fun with when I was playing at the various pizza parlors and dives around town. I enter the chord progression right here. I pick out a style. This is a bossa nova. It's going to change to a jazz beat about here where that is.
All right.
When I play it, it comes up like this. See, now, my band would have gotten angry at that mistake. The computer doesn't care.
It likes it, right?
Right. Well, you can always edit. You can always edit.
It doesn't drink.
What?
All right. That's cool. Now, when you're playing
right
on
here.
The keyboard, is it actually showing up there on the
screen?
Yes,
cool. You said that word.
I always hate to talk when you're playing because I want to go over the music.
Anyway, that'll play until I get tired of it.
All right. Now, what exactly can this program be used for?
Well, here's what I used it for some time back. I needed to write some music to go behind an audition videotape for my magic show. So I looked around for something, and I remembered that we had this particular tune that was in one of Dad's piano books called The Magic Man.
Now, your dad was a musician.
He still is.
Okay.
And a lot better than I am.
Okay.
But I thought, well, heck, I'll just use Magic Man because even in the little piano book, there was a cartoon of me doing magic.
Right.
So I entered the chord progression. And I wrote a bridge for it right in here. And
I think we actually have a picture of you as a magician.
Mm-hmm. I hope so.
I think that one, Ty, can you bring that up real fast? I think we have a picture. Oh, look at him. That's him. Pretty great. Yeah. Huh? It's Merlin.
Right. I do that at the Renaissance Festival and at Scarborough Fair up in Waxahachie. Right. Well, anyway, I went ahead and entered the chord progression, and I saved that as a MIDI file. And there it is right there. Save as a standard MIDI file.
Right.
Okay.
And it converts it over.
It made it into a MIDI file. Okay. It's grinding it to disk. Okay. Now, I exit the program. Then I go back to my good old buddy Cakewalk Professional here. There we go. And I pick up the file. Magic Man right there. Now, at that point, all I have to do is play the thing and record the lead over it. So I bring out the record here. And I set it up here.
It's counting in.
Yeah, and so I would play the tune here. Now, I've already got this thing finished, so I'm actually going to call that up. It's a much better idea to do this. There's Magic Man as it came out. Now, this is the complete thing. I went in and grabbed part of the drum riff to give me a riff is a jazz term that they use a whole lot. I did that to give it a lead in, and it comes out like this. It took 45 minutes to do this. Now, if I had had to enter every track separately, it would have taken me a couple of days. But by using this band in the box as a compositional tool, I was able to do the whole mess in 45 minutes.
So you actually used a combination of band in the box and Cakewalk.
That's exactly right.
Now, Cakewalk, you said, was a...
It's a sequencer.
Sequencer, and band in the box is more of just a composition, it's recreational.
Right. You know, it's, what they've done is they're using a combination of artificial intelligence and other technology to make it possible for you to do a lot of work in a very little space. Right. The song files on Band in a Box are only about 700 bytes.
And these are MIDI files?
They're Band in a Box files. Now, the MIDI file on this would be about, let's say, 19K. Right. But on the Band in a Box files themselves, they're quite short. And that's a big advantage because you can store lots of them on one particular thing. And Band in a Box also gives you a choice of 100 different styles that includes piano, bass, drum, sometimes guitar, and some of them even have melody tracks on them. So it's a very nice thing to have.
I think we want to do this, as long as we're talking about music, I think we want to go and why don't we do your opening music here?
Yes.
Vic, you actually wrote the opening song for the show, for this show.
Worked with your illustrious director,
right.
Todd Huey.
We actually have two tracks we're going to show here. One is our opening with no music, but just the sound effects.
Right.
And you're going to play the little music so you can see what it sounds like. And then we're going to combine the two and actually show how this actually worked.
Okay. Let's do it.
So why don't you go ahead and roll the tape of just the opening with no music, just sound effects. Again, I like to put our... No one even recognizes that.
Yeah.
But it sounds kind of funny because there's no music.
Yeah.
So why don't you go ahead and play the music?
Music, just generically, let me say, music is such a powerful tool. And people, I think, don't even often realize the power that music conveys unless they're without it.
Right.
You know, the next time you watch a movie that you are so scared by or so moved by, turn the volume down for a second, and something's missing terribly. Now, this is the original that... If you tune into the show, you know that it's... Now, it's melodically, it's just basically a pattern. It's just a rhythm. When Todd came to me and said, I want something for this show, he just wanted something kind of mechanical, you know, like driving and a strong, powerful thing. He wanted it to start. Let me rewind it. Rewind it.
Todd, I think we need to show it. Let's show it. Let's show the two of them together now. It sounds great when you put the whole thing together like that. I think we're going to have to take a... We'll come back and talk about this more. We're going to have to take a quick break here for our computer art gallery.
That's what it's called.
Yeah, the computer art gallery. But we're going to take some phone calls as soon as we get back, so stay tuned and we'll be right back. Welcome back to Computer Workshop. Today we're discussing editing music with your PC. Our guests are Vic Mignon of SoundWorks and Bill Palmer of HAL-PC's MIDI Special Interest Group. It's great to be back here.
Hey, yeah. We're back.
Did you happen to see, I don't know if you saw the great things people send in, but it is great. I like the art
stuff
and animation.
It fascinates me.
Computers are fun. I'll say that again, all right? That's my new little
computers
thing.
Computers are scary.
And they're fun and they're great.
Oh, they're really fun. I have to be a nerd like me.
I'm a computer nerd.
Yeah. I think what we're going to do, before we go any further, I think we ought to explain maybe to our viewers just what you guys do.
Yeah.
Why don't you tell us in 30 seconds or less what SoundWorks does.
SoundWorks is an audio for broadcast production facility. What that means is that anything that has to do with audio as it relates to broadcasting, radio commercials, TV spots, film scores, looping. Just last week we had young Indiana Jones, people from Lucasfilm here, and we're doing some looping or lip syncing for the Young Indiana Jones Chronicle show.
So you use this in real life?
Yeah, we do that kind of work, and I'm on staff there as a composer. Somebody comes in and says, we need a jingle for such and such a product, or we need music for such and such a TV show, or such and such a radio spot. And that's what I do. And
Great. We
do all different kinds of work there, from cleaning up sound. We've got digital workstations now that are top-notch, beautiful things that allow us to do things that used to take hours before. And basically anything that has anything to do with audio
sound
for
works.
Broadcast, it works at SoundWorks. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know, some people may not know what HAL-PC is. Why don't you tell us HAL-PC and what
the MIDI... computer on 2001. Yeah.
Right. Well, it's related to that in a way.
HAL-PC
is the Houston Area League of PC Users. We're an IBM and compatibles specific user group. We've got over 10,000 members. We're based in Houston. The largest PC user group in the world. And the MIDI SIG is a MIDI special interest group. It's all of the guys who are members of HAL-PC, who are interested in using MIDI. Some people don't know anything about it. Others are guys who know a whole lot about it. But we all get together once a month, and we discuss what's going on in the world of MIDI. Beginners come in and ask questions, and we try to help them, either by keeping them from losing money on bad investments on software that doesn't work or hardware that won't work. Or we try to help them make their stuff work a little better. We show new software and all that kind of stuff.
Well, most big cities have big PC users groups, and also for Macs and Ataris and other things.
That's right.
It's good. I think it's a good thing for people to join those kind of things.
Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah.
We've got a bunch of calls. You want to start?
Let's take a phone call.
Okay.
Sure.
We've got Dennis from Houston. Dennis, do you have a question?
Oh, yeah. I've got several questions, and this is basically for Bill. You touched a while ago on sampled versus synthesized waveform lookups. What really is the difference, and what is the advantage of each? Also, is there anything available that allows waveform manipulation now, like the original synthesizers?
I couldn't hear your last word there. Like the original what?
The original synthesizers, like the old Moog synthesizers, where you actually...
Oh, you mean like the old Moogs and so forth. Well, yes. Let me start back at the beginning. Even samplers are in themselves a kind of synthesizer. A synthesizer is simply a device that creates sounds. That's all it is. And it can do it by using analog methods, by taking different oscillators and running them against each other. Or I can use digital methods by using digitally controlled oscillators and running them against each other. Or I can use digital samples and put pieces of them together. It can manipulate them, can do all sorts of things with them. And all of these things are capable of doing things that the old synthesizers did. The biggest advantage of the digital stuff is that it's more stable. It doesn't drift in tuning. The old Moogs went out of tune so quickly that it was very difficult to really use them in live situations. And these things we have now are very stable, and in a little bitty box it costs less than $500. I can put preset sounds that are considerably more interesting than the stuff the old Moogs had, and I can still manipulate them. There's software you can use on your computer called an editor program that will allow you to edit sounds. There are librarian programs that allow you to store them, and you can dump them into your synthesizers using what are called system exclusive dumps or patch dumps. So you can do all of that with most of your sophisticated synthesizers. Some of them you can't do it with at all, but the D50s and the DX11s, DX21s, and so forth, or even this Kawai I have over here, or the MT32, you can do all of that stuff with it. Modern stuff is no exception.
Does that answer your question?
I've been disappointed in some of the sounds that I've heard from the...
Not today.
No, not today. From sampled keyboards. I mean, the pianos always sound really good, but a lot of the things like strings and horns have a tendency to sound kind of like old Wurlitzers with drawbars on them. Is there anything that sounds better than the other?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, one of the things you can do, one of the big advantages of the samplers, is you can get CD-ROMs that have these sounds on them, and you can just record them with your samplers.
Yeah.
If you don't like the sounds that come with it, you can change those. One of the problems, I think, with especially true with string and brass sounds, because they're really basically the same waveform, it's just the attacks that are different and the envelopes that are slightly different.
That's really, right. you're hitting it right there, is the attacks and the envelopes are really, I guess, what I'm disappointed with.
Yeah. Right. Take a look at Wendy Carlos's Secrets of Synthesis. Right. That album will help you a whole lot.
Okay.
All right, thanks for calling, Des. We're going to move on to another caller, right? Okay, thanks for calling. Oh, we have you, Leona from Houston. Do you have a question?
Yes, I was wanting to find out where I could take a class
to learn about MIDI and keyboards and things?
Yes.
First thing that I would do is, I don't want to push HAL-PC by any means, but you might want to at least check out our special interest group and let us talk to you a little bit. There are people who do teach courses. I know Houston Community College has got some courses, and also Leisure Learning Unlimited has some, so you might...
But in other cities, there's users groups like HAL-PC.
Right.
In other cities that probably have a MIDI SIG.
They do.
A special interest group, and they probably also have, I'm sure they have community college and things that teach computers and keyboards. And
this is pretty much standard all over the country.
Well, I have an Apple computer. Could I do it with my Apple computer?
Absolutely. Now, which kind of Apple do you have, a Mac or an old Apple II?
An Apple IIe.
Okay. If you'll check with your local Apple users group, they will be able to help you.
They have meetings.
Right.
Yeah, they sure
do.
Yeah, I just spoke a couple days ago with the professor over at HCC who coordinates their program, and he was telling me about...
That's MIDI, Houston Community College.
Right, MIDI classes that they have over there.
Mm-hmm. All right.
When do they have their meetings?
The best thing to do is we have your phone number. We can call you back. And I know I'm a member of the Houston Apple users group. I know we can find out for you.
All right.
All right? Thanks a lot.
Appreciate it.
All right. Tony, how can we help you today?
Well, I have copied this thing on a floppy, and I need to modify it. Is there any way it's come in as a block? Is there any way I can modify that block on this floppy that I have?
You have a copy of what?
A block that I have gotten off of another thing. I'm going to HCC.
Right.
And I'm taking AutoCAD.
Oh, AutoCAD.
Right. And
okay.
So I've got a floppy at home and I need to modify.
Okay. Well, today we're talking about music, editing music on your PC. But I'll tell you what, I actually know AutoCAD inside and out. And I'll get your number and I'll call you back after the show. How about that?
Hey, that works great.
All right. Okay. Sorry. Thanks.
Uh-huh.
Thanks for calling. Richard, do you have a question?
Yeah, I'd like to know. I see the user was the guy with the beard was using a PC.
Right.
I want to know why there wasn't anything talked about as far as using the Atari and the Amiga, which are widely used in the MIDI world.
I did mention that you can go across platforms with them. The Atari is especially popular in Europe. It's considerably more popular there than it is here. Right now, by actual numbers, PC users outnumber all of the rest of the MIDI world by about 3-1. That's if you take all the other computers and put them together. There are about 3 times more people using PCs than anything else, but the Atari has a big advantage in that it has a built-in MIDI interface, and it's not real expensive. It's real easy to use, and there is some good stuff available for the Atari. The Amiga is just a little bit less flexible. They're great for video, but they've neglected their sound capabilities a lot, unfortunately. That's going to change in the very near future.
They had a program called Super Jam, which was, speaking of Amiga, and I don't know if you're familiar with that, but it was for people that were not really musicians and to get them involved in as far as learning music.
There are similar things out for all platforms.
I didn't know that.
They're getting closer and closer together all the time.
Okay. Right. Thanks a lot. Like your show.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks a lot.
There's a wide variety of different types of systems. Some more widely used than others, but. Mm-hmm.
And the other reason, I mean, completely different from that, the main reason we're showing PCs is because we decided on the first series of these shows we would stick to PCs. Once we get into the second series of this computer workshop show, we'll actually probably show different platforms. But we've decided to stick with the first couple of shows all on PCs just because that's what hardware we have here and everything else. We don't mean to slight anybody, but we just try to, you know, keep everything consistent for the first couple of shows.
No, that's true. And really, an important thing to remember is that MIDI has become very flexible now, and
right.
You can do cross-platform
reading. Doesn't make any difference.
And the programs all work fairly similarly now.
Yes.
They didn't in the older days, but now they work very, very similarly.
Right. We have another call here. Todd, do you have a question?
Yeah, I was calling. I was going to ask Bill Palmer about an IBM program that sequences that might be able to help me because I have an older keyboard with MIDI. And I was wondering, my keyboard receives in Omni only,
mm-hmm.
so I don't receive in Poly mode. And I was wondering if there was a software sequencer that would do the MIDI filtering for me, you know, because I have other keyboards too.
Ooh.
What kind of keyboard is your older keyboard?
It's a Krumar Bit 1. It's Italian.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. Those were neat. Okay. What kind of a MIDI interface do you have?
Right now, I'm using an Amiga, which I'm going to abandon because there's not enough software for it, and I'm going to go with an IBM.
Okay, if you'll get a Music Quest MQX32M, that'll give you two ports out. You can put the Krumar on one and put the other stuff on the other.
What was that again? What was that?
Music Quest MQX32M. It has two separate MIDI ports on it so that you have actually 32 channels, and it works under DOS or Windows. So that's the easiest way to solve the problem. That way you can put the Krumar on one output and put the other keyboard on the other output, and you can just isolate the Krumar that way, and then that's the easiest solution. There are others, but that's the easiest one I can come up with.
Did you get that, Todd?
Yeah, I did. I just wanted to add that the name of the guy at Sequential was Dave Smith, I think, instead of Dick Smith, if I remember right.
Oh, you're right.
That was his brother.
Dick Smith is the guy that had the cheap electronics company.
He was only Dick to his friends. Yeah. His closest friends called him that.
Oh, I see.
I'm not going to.
Bye, guys.
Okay.
Hey, thanks for calling. Okay, while we're talking about this, why don't we go ahead and show? We need to show some more fun things on the computer. What
this
exactly
is Encore. This is a scoring program. Now, one of the questions that I get on the phone all the time is, where can I get software that will allow me to print sheet music? And I usually ask first, why do you need sheet music? And usually they don't know. They have no idea. And so I say, well, forget it. But if you do need sheet music, if you're writing for educational stuff, or if you're writing for a band, this is a scoring program. Now, I'm going to take a MIDI file. Let's try this again here. Let's go to the import file. There we go. This is a Bach two-part invention. That's converting this into sheet music. Now, that is a basic score for this. I'm going to make a few minor changes. I'm going to go into the staff sheet. I'm going to eliminate this name here. And we're going to eliminate this name here because I don't need that out there. My piano player knows that that's treble and bass because he knows what those clefs mean. Then I'll highlight this, and I'll come down and highlight that, and I will join those stabs like this with a brace so it looks like real piano music. Then I can go in and I can insert a title up here if I want to, and when I hit the print thing over here, it'll print out on my laser printer and look just like that.
Beautiful.
And that looks just like the stuff you see in a real music book.
I've got it holding up right now.
That'll print out on a laser printer, or you can print it out on a dot matrix. Since this one runs under Windows, you don't have to worry about what the MIDI drivers are, and you don't have to worry about your print drivers. It's all there, and Windows takes care of all the dirty work. And it does a lot of this automatically. The only thing I had to do is do a little bit of tweaking of where the notes that had the sharps and flats were, because they had sort of run together. You can look here and see that they're hard to read, so I just grabbed them with a mouse and moved them over, and that gave me a little more room there, and you could see that was actually E-flat instead of a...
So every note is changeable.
That's right. I can do anything with it.
Yeah, and the
and
neat
I just
thing
did.
The neat thing about this is that you could write something. Let's say, for instance, somebody out there composes something on their keyboard. The beauty again of MIDI is that nothing's actually recorded and set in stone. What they've got is a disc or a sequence full of numbers and pulses, and they can get that hooked up with something that with a program that prints out music, and without having to play it again or without having to, you know, start and stop or sit there with a pen.
Right.
Anything that they've already recorded can be written out for them. I just did it a couple weeks ago with something that was already pre-sequenced, but I wanted somebody to play it the way I would have played it,
right,
if I could have. And in the certain situation, and that's another beauty of MIDI, is anything you've already recorded can be printed out.
And not only that, you can take this down to your local print house, and if they have either a Macintosh or a PC connected up to a Linotronics or a high-resolution printer, they can give you an absolute perfect professional piece of
right.
work.
That's great.
Right. It's really handy.
Let's take some more calls.
Talk to me.
Okay, we've got Brian from Kingwood. Brian, how can we help you today?
I write music, and I've used MIDI, and I was wondering if there are particular publishers that accept music for MIDI, and if so, would you know any?
Do you mean in MIDI file form, or what?
Yeah, they're in MIDI file form.
There are. This is really sort of a strange thing. You can buy sequences already done of popular tunes. The question is, how are you going to get the publisher to recognize the market you're looking for? It's easier to get things published when people know what they are than it is when they don't know what they are.
What kind of stuff do you write, Brian?
Yeah.
Do you think it would be easier to just tape it and then send it to a publisher?
Yeah. What kind of music do you write, Brian?
It would be pop, probably.
Okay.
Considered.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd say absolutely. And I tell you what, let me just throw out something that I like to do when I record stuff that I've written, Brian. Is to sequence as much of it as you feel comfortable sequencing, and then to take it into a studio, and record your vocals, because nowadays with music the way it is, people expect a real high end quality right. demonstration of your music. Nobody's gonna accept something that's far less than what people expect to hear nowadays. And another neat thing you can do, Brian, is bring in one live player. Bring in a live guitarist or a live sax player and have him play over top of your sequence, and it makes what may have been a somewhat mechanical sequence come alive and make everything seem real. I would suggest that you'd go ahead and lay it down to tape rather than trying to get somebody at one of these labels to to go to the trouble of loading it into a computer set. That gives you the chance to set levels and make changes.
That sounds that wonderful. Maybe I'll do that next time.
One thing, one thing too is remember,
this is my first time, so it would probably be easier and cheaper just to send a tape in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, send them in. The easiest thing it is for them to listen to it, send it on a DAT. They like to hear fine quality.
Okay.
That sounds great.
Thanks. Thanks for calling. We've got Charlie from College Station. Do you have a question?
Oh, yes. Hello. This is actually the first time that I got to be on your show here. I never get to work usually today. But my question is this. I'm not a musician myself, okay? But my sister plays the piano, and either one of these two gentlemen could probably answer me which kind of... I would like to buy her a keyboard that simulates a piano as well as possible, and then maybe I have a PC, and I do have the Sound Blaster board that has the MIDI kit in it.
Right.
Of course, I had a question about the MIDI part of it too later. What is your advice? What kind of piano I can get that is... Because I think that also the feel is important. See, I'm not a musician myself, so I don't know, but something that simulates the piano exactly.
Okay. Let me say this. Any of these good synthesizers are MIDI compatible nowadays. I mean, you can hook them up to your PC. That's not a problem. This reminds me of something that we wanted to touch on, and that is there's a real big difference between being a piano player and being a keyboard player. Because somebody that would utilize this kind of a board would be somebody who would be likely to play a lot of different instruments or something like that.
Uh-huh.
You can buy for considerably less money a keyboard that is a piano synthesizer or a piano and a harpsichord and maybe an electric piano, four or five different keyboard type sounds that are top quality sampled sounds. What I would say the best thing to do is to just maybe find some secret way or sneaky way of getting your sister, it's your sister, right?
Yes, yes.
Getting your sister into a music store, and hearing is believing. I mean, you know, it boils basically down to if you like the sound, if it sounds like a real piano to you, then, you know, then buy it. Maybe take her in and let her listen to some of these. Most of these things nowadays have MIDI outs and ins on them that you can hook them up to your PC.
Well, I was, I follow what you're saying. I was looking also for, like, I don't know if you can say that on the air, but, what companies would be a good one for you? I mean, I'm an Aggie over here. I'm a student, so I can afford, $5,000 worth of equipment for my sister. But, you know, $500, you know, something like that.
Okay, for one thing, a couple of things to remember. A synthesizer doesn't feel the same as a piano. It has a different kind of feel to it, and that's going to be more important to her, or more noticeable to
yes.
her than the sound.
Called weighted keys.
Yeah, in fact, some weighted keys aren't really weighted. They just have weights attached to them. That's not the same thing at all. But you can get various consumer line keyboards that have that feel pretty decent. So take her to a music store and let her play around on them and see what she
Here's
likes.
Here's some names for you. Kawai.
Uh-huh.
Korg.
Uh-huh.
Kurzweil.
Uh-huh.
Yamaha.
Uh-huh.
Roland.
As far as acoustic piano samplers, though, some of those first names are kind of leading the way.
Okay, hopefully that'll answer your question.
I had one more question here.
Actually, we're going to have to wrap it up a little bit here. Well, we've got your number. We'll call you back after the show. How about that?
Yeah, cool, thanks.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank all of you.
All right, thank you. I think the way to do is we're talking about different ways of people learning things, too. We could probably show some of these as examples. And of ways that they can find out what's going on in the MIDI world.
Like that's one of the best magazines there is, if you, especially if you can get some back issues of
Keyboard magazine.
Keyboard.
The other one is the Electronic Musician. Right?
Magician?
Magician. I almost said musician.
Electronic Musician is a little bit more technical as far as the wires and bits and bytes than keyboard, but you need them both.
All right. We're going to have to wrap it up today. But before we go, I'd like our viewers at home to get your pens, pencils, and keyboards ready to take down our phone numbers. Computer Workshop values your input, so feel free to call our viewer comment line or log on to our bulletin board service. Those numbers will be coming up soon. I'd like to thank both our guests, Vic Mignon and Bill Palmer, for joining us today. And next week, we'll be taking a look at handheld and palm-top computers. We'll show you how these little powerhouses work and how they'll link up to your PC. I'm Steve Reeves for Computer Workshop. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week.
If you have any comments about Computer Workshop or would like information on donating your artwork to the art gallery, call our viewer comment line at 713-749-8345. Don't forget to leave your name and phone number. For those who prefer to communicate through a modem, why not log on to Houston Public Television's Computer Information Service? Dial 713-749-8371, then select the option for Computer Workshop Forum. For a copy of this show, send a check or money order for $29.95 to Computer Workshop, KUHT-TV, 4513 Cullen Boulevard, Houston, Texas, 77004. Ask for show number 108.